With the world focused on the war in Syria and the increasing global threat of Daesh, there is concern the danger posed by militants in another region is being underestimated. Africa. Militant groups are operating across the vast continent. And Nigeria is home to the world's most deadly terror group, Boko Haram. The newsmaker's Yvette McCullough takes a look at the threat militants pose in Africa.
Fear, violence, and survival have become a fact of life in many parts of Africa. Militant groups have exploited instability and power vacuums across the continent. Some of them now control large territories. Many are offshoots of Al-Qaeda and are fighting amongst themselves for power and territory. And governments and militaries are struggling to counter the growing threat. Groups with links to Daesh have captured territory in the north. Militants claimed responsibility for bombing down a Russian passenger plane in Egypt's Sinai in October. And Daesh has taken advantage of the breakdown of law and order in neighbouring Libya. It has also crossed over into Tunisia, carrying out attacks targeting the country's tourism industry. Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb is also waging war in Africa. The group mainly operates in this region. While its influence has decreased since 2013, it still has a presence. It attacked a hotel in Bamako in November last year and killed dozens of people in a hotel in Burkina Faso's capital in January. The single most deadly militant group in the world is Nigeria's Boko Haram. According to the Global Terrorism Index, the group killed 6,644 people in 2014, surpassing even Daesh. Al-Shabaab once controlled large parts of Somalia, but has now been pushed back into small pockets of rural territory. But while the group is in retreat, it is far from gone. It's carried out four major attacks so far this year. On Sunday, at least 30 were killed in twin explosions in the southern city of Bardoa. As the threat increases, so too does the regional and international response. A coalition of troops, including Cameroon and Chad, have had success in fighting Boko Haram, and the US has pledged $5 million in support. In Somalia, African Union forces have been fighting Al-Shabaab since 2007. They say they will reinforce military operations, but the EU has decided to cut funding for AMISOM troops by 20%. That has raised concern about the future of the peacekeeping mission, and whether failure there could further destabilise the region. Yvette McCullough, The Newsmakers.
The Newsmakers spoke to Somalia's president, Hassan Sheikh Mahmoud. He told us that some Boko Haram fighters have been trained in Somalia, highlighting the fact that militant groups are prepared to travel across Africa to receive specialised training. Our correspondent, Zaina Awad, sat down with a Somali leader and talked security, corruption, and Africa's militancy problem in this TRT World exclusive interview.
You've recently talked about links between Al-Shabaab and Boko Haram. What more can you tell us?
You know, this one has to understand the dynamics of Al-Shabaab and how they come to exist in Somalia. One common phenomena for all extremist organizations is extremism is a sort of an ideology. And the ideologies have no borders and have no citizenship. One of the major reasons why Al-Shabaab became Somali was because in Somalia there was territories that were not governed by no one. So Al-Shabaab, they invited, or there was a small local organization mainly led by people who came from Afghanistan during the jihad against the Soviet Union and later on with Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda. When they came there, now they see that this is a great opportunity and they invited many of their friends. They get together there. They trained Somalis, they trained non-Somalis in the neighboring countries. This is what made now come all other extremist organizations that are linked to Al-Qaeda. They said the easiest place, the closest place is Somalia. So that's why many of the Nigerians come to Somalia and they were traded, number one, and then they have been taken with them, non-Nigerians from other African countries, went them together. That's how Boko Haram and many of the Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, they were also trained, Al-Qaeda in the North Africa, they were also trained there. Because there was a free territory that nobody, no threats, no nothing, no information. So this is what made, and there are some reports that indicate the numbers and the people that have been trained in Somalia and who later on operate in Nigeria.
Are you saying that there are other extremist groups in Africa that have also trained with Al-Shabaab in Somalia?
In recent times, this has been denied because there was a times when more than two-thirds of Somalia, the central and the southern regions of Somalia. Somalia is 18 regions. 11 of those 18 regions, one time, was fully controlled by Al-Shabaab. That was the days in 2000, 2001, until 2006, 2007, when the whole thing then changed. And then when I came to the office in 2012, Al-Shabaab was just in Mogadishu, outside Mogadishu, just they were pushed a little bit outside Mogadishu. There were times that the government, the transitional government, was controlling only four districts out of the 17 districts of Mogadishu. So from there, we pushed Al-Shabaab now to the remote villages.
Why is Al-Shabaab still able to operate in parts of Somalia?
Because, you know, Al-Shabaab, they were controlling the whole territory one time. And then when I came, they were having the capacity to attack the state house, to attack the parliament, to attack the justice house where all the courts do, to attack the AMISOM headquarters in the Mogadishu International Airport. Today, as you can recall back on the record, they are attacking restaurants, hotels, busy streets where people get together. Sure. That's an indication how their capacity now is depleted. But still, they are not eliminated because the war against Al-Shabaab or against extremism is not military only. So far, we have been doing the military war. But the war has an economic aspect, social aspect, of which rehabilitation aspect. There are certain other aspects that are still remaining. They melted down into the society now. They don't have their own territory, but they just melt down the society. They are there watching, and they attack any vulnerable place and any vulnerable person.
Why is Al-Shabaab still able to operate in south-central Somalia?
Maybe there's a lot of reasons, but the only one reason, very important, is there were local administrations for a long time there. Over 18 years, both Puntland and Somaliland, there were local administrations that controlled the territory. But in south-central Somalia, there were no. It was an empty vacuum space where they can occupy. That's the difference.